This is the 2020 Toyota CHR, and it doesn't only have a very Honda-like name, but it also has a very Honda-like butt. I don't know about you, but I see lots of Civic or latest CRV in those taillights, but the rest of it is for sure unique and intricate. I'm sure it's a love it or hate it design, but in a car like this that isn't for everyone, this strategy will surely pay off. So for those who like it, the design is definitely a highlight, with a sloped roof and hidden rear door handles, making it look like a three-door hatchback with a lift kit. In reality, the CHR, that stands for Compact High Rider, has similar ground clearance and driving height like a Mercedes GLA, so it's kind of a crossover, really. The drawback with the North American model is that under the hood, it has a rather unattractive drivetrain with a very basic 2.0-liter four-cylinder engine and a CVT transmission sending power to the front wheels only. There's no all-wheel drive option available, which is a real shame for places like Canada with the snow and everything. But the truth is that the 144 horsepower and 139 pound-feet of torque the engine makes aren't really enough to disturb the excellent tuning of the chassis. Essentially, that kind of eliminates the need for all-wheel drive. However, in deep snow, I'm really sure it would have helped. The engine might not be exotic, but it is smooth and cheap to run, and should be as reliable as it gets. The car isn't that heavy, so power is enough to move it at a decent pace. 0 to 100 kilometers an hour comes in 12.2 seconds, and the CVT transmission is good enough to not attract any attention, which I guess means it works pretty well for a CVT. It also has 7 simulated gears for manual shifting, but I really don't see anyone using that. Fuel economy isn't that bad. For the week that I've spent with the car, it's been averaging 8.5 liters per 100 kilometers, and that's regular gas, so that's not bad at all. The suspension tuning is fantastic. They've taken full advantage of the extra available suspension travel and fitted dampers and spring that absorb road imperfections in a very satisfying way. In parallel, when tackling corners, it doesn't lean as much as you'd expect. I mean, you feel the anti-roll bars kind of work and sort it out. It's, dare I say, a little bit of fun too. I mean, I'm a really big fan of how they've set up the suspension. I know it's a budget car, but you know what? They did a fantastic job. I'm really liking this thing, and the steering also feels pretty good too. I think they learned a few lessons while developing the Supra. Toyota states it has a rear multi-link suspension. However, this looks to me like double wishbone. Nevertheless, it has upper urethane bushings. And you can tell they've used the good stuff because, honestly, this rear suspension works really well. It's one of the most compliant systems in the category. Grip levels are high enough, the chassis is very well sorted, and if you push too hard, the stability control kindly tones down the pace to bring back the balance. It is very forgiving, something that could not be the case if it had more power. It's not very forgiving when it comes to colors though. Listen to a few of them. Supersonic red, hot lava orange, knockout silver metallic. These are bang on for this bold styling of the car. I love it. The interior is very well made. Soft to the touch materials have been used in more places than I thought I would find. And the design, while dynamic and modern, it remains very user-friendly and simple. Ergonomics are straightforward, the infotainment system is simple and nice, it supports both Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, and the sound system is great. You don't get a wireless charger, which I guess is a miss, but you do get a little pocket here for your smartphone. However, it's very small. I doubt any modern smartphone will fit in there. You also don't get a sunroof, because who doesn't need diamond patterns in the roof? And you also do not get a start-stop system. It's funny how all around the world, the CHR is a hybrid exclusively, like in Europe, for example. But in North America, it gets none of the eco stuff. Like, none. Oh, sorry, that's a lie. The AC has an eco button, which is completely hilarious. Roominess is pretty good in the front. The seats are very nice and support the body really well. The rear seats are a bit tight for legroom. Headroom is not that bad. But with shorter passengers in the front, the problems become very minor. Their rear windows are tiny, so kids might complain about not being able to see outside, but at least they open all the way down. The trunk is a good 377 liters. It has a very good wide opening, and you can approach it and just drop your stuff in. but it does have an inconvenient handle for closing the hatch, because your fingers have to be pointing backwards, and that's not really my style. Built on the Toyota New Global Architecture C platform, prices start in Canada at $23,650 for the base LE trim and go all the way up to $28,800 for the limited like this one. Special mention to the fact that even the LE base trim level gets LED headlights. Kudos to Toyota for doing that. I mean, I see premium cars with halogen headlights and I go mental. Bravo, Toyota, for giving us headlights that actually help us see at night. It is a safety thing. Thank you. With diamond patterns all over the place, it will surely find its own fan base. I already see a lot of them driving around, so despite the lack of all-wheel drive and an exciting drivetrain, the CHR is a quality product for those who want to spice up their daily commute with something that looks a bit different. Overall score is 7.8 out of 10. It's a good car. If you have anything like this on your shopping list, make sure you go test drive one. It's actually a very interesting car. Till next time, be well. See you later. Perfect.